I think one of the most common reactions that I get when I tell people that I've discovered new species is utter surprise that there are new species left to be discovered.
That's the male of the new species. That's the first male we got.
No way.
Yeah.
What we're doing is looking under every rock, every log, every debris on the ground. So you really have to like put yourself into the shoes of an arachnid and imagine if I was an arachnid, where would I be hiding? I'm definitely not in the lab all the time. That's really a stereotype that's inaccurate. I think the stereotype that I'd like to imagine myself in a little bit more is like Indiana Jones sort of situation, exploring the unknown and trying to discover something new.
Why did it have to be snakes?
I am scared of snakes, legit. I don't even want to admit that right now. I'm really scared of mosquitoes, and I'm scared of birds flying out of the bushes at night. There's moments when I'm in the field that I don't feel like it's the most glamorous job. When I haven't showered and I run out of water and I just want to go home and watch some Netflix. Hello, it's the end of my first day out in the field, but I'm already pretty tired, hot and sweaty. Hello, it's Lauren. Just got back from my morning of collecting and it was hot and sweaty, as you can probably see. At the end of the day, it's something I really love doing and that's everything. Arachnids are both diurnal and nocturnal, and arachnids are often what we call cryptic species, which means that they're trying to blend in, and so that makes them really hard to see. And so we do have a number of tools that we also bring along with us when we go out into the field. One of those is a leaf litter sifter, where you shake all the leaves around, and at the bottom is a funnel that collects all of the little leaf particles and lots of insects and arachnids, and even some other weird things like amphipods, which are a kind of crustacean. We also bring a vegetation beater, or a beet sheet, which is kind of like a white kite that you hold under vegetation as you knock against a stick or something against the vegetation, and spiders and insects like rain down. Sometimes ants rain down into your shirt too, which is not the most fun. Then you use a pooter, which is like a mouth vacuum, to suck all the insects and arachnids up and collect them into a vial. I wanna get like a logo screen printed on my fanny pack that says just poot it. That'd be good, right?
That's a jumping spider.
As soon as you get back to the base camp and start looking at what you've collected, you may notice that you've collected all the same few species, which is a sign of a disturbed forest, or you've collected a lot of different species, which is a sign of a healthy forest.
This is some of the stuff that we collected over the last 2 weeks. It might not look like a ton, but in each of those little baggies there's anywhere from 2 to a few hundred or maybe even a couple thousand specimens.
Once night completely falls, we'll take out our ultraviolet lamps and start looking for scorpions. We'll work till 1 o'clock in the morning or so and then try to get some sleep.
I don't know exactly for sure what it is, but I'm gonna find out.
You know, I think that my research stems from a need that I have as an individual to understand the biodiversity of the world. Somewhere between 30 and 50% of the arachnid species on Earth are only known to science. What I've made sort of my personal life's mission is to try to document the remaining 50%. And what that requires is a lot of like on the ground hard work and also back in the lab work in the microscope and in the genetics lab.
And this one is a new species.
We're pretty excited.
Yeah.
It's like the whipped cream on top of the ice cream sundae. And we found it the first day, and this one's an adult female, which means it's a really valuable specimen. We can actually use it for describing the species formally. And I don't know, I couldn't be more happy.
We're losing species at a rate that's higher than the rate we're discovering species. And unless we understand what's out there, it's impossible to understand how to protect it and how to conserve it. So for me, I feel a fundamental duty to the Earth, really, to document and improve our knowledge of species on the planet.
In this next episode, see firsthand the deadly risks a volcanologist takes when examining an erupting volcano. Thanks for watching, and be sure to subscribe to Seeker.